Hey everyone, can you guys hear me all right? Yeah? Okay, good. So this is Gophers Writing Elephants, Writing Postgres Tools in Go. So who am I? I'm a senior engineer at Procore. I work on availability and performance, but now I've been shifting mostly to security at Procore. And I've been writing Go code actively for about 2 years. Let me shift this thing a little bit. What? Oh, am I? Yeah. So who is this talk for? Basically, I just wanted to take a step back and say that I'm not going to be talking too much about like writing applications in Go that interface with Postgres. This is mostly focused on like operations, DBAs, database engineers, and that and the tooling around that. Some of the stuff I'll be talking about is very relatable to that, but just not going to be focusing on that too much. So first off, let's do a little overview of Go. So Go is an open source programming language built with the idea of making it easy to build simple, reliable, and efficient software. Go was created by Google, and it was built for Google as well. And that's important when looking at the language of the community, that there's a big focus on things like reliability and being good for teams, which are kind of distilled down to simplicity, and being good for building the kinds of things they need to build, which you'll see pretty heavily in the standard library with things like awesome networking libraries and awesome cryptography libraries in the standard library. And another really important piece is this article written by Rob Pike, who's one of the three co-creators of Go, titled Less is Exceptionally More, where he just makes this point that Go is purposely lacking certain features, and that it's not that they don't understand that these features exist, but they've made this explicit decision to not include them, to keep the language small and simplistic, and for there to be like a single way to do thing, and what a single way to do a thing. And so for example, like there's a for loop in Go, and that is the only way to loop. And there it is structured in a way where you can do different types of for loops, or you know, infinite loops with that. But that is, you know, there's no map, there's no while, there's none of that other stuff. And of course, it's statically typed, compiled, and garbage collected. And it looks a little something like this, which I hope you guys can see all right. With this being a hello world, with the world being in Mandarin characters with Unicode support by default. So why go with Postgres? I think there's three main reasons I want to go over, and not in any particular order of importance, just order. So the first one is performance. Go is pretty fast. So this is kind of a contrite example, but it's the best visual I could find, really, where the y-axis is requests per second to a JSON API over HTTP, and Go is at 21,000 requests per second, with the next one down being Node at 14,000 requests per second, and the third one being Vapor, which is Swift on the back end. So it's pretty fast. The garbage collector is pretty solid and pretty fast. There's been an extensive amount of work over the last, I'd say, like three or four releases. Goes on a six-month release cycle. So over the last 2 years on making the garbage collector really, really fast. Concurrency is a breeze. So in this example, we've got this function say that takes a string, loops five times, you know, sleeps for 100 milliseconds, and then prints the string passed in. To launch something in the background, in what's called a Go routine, you just put the keyword Go in front of your function invocation. And that launches it what's called a Go routine, which is, you can think of similarly to like a thread, even though it's very much not a thread. And it's, you know, concurrent, always concurrent and potentially parallel. And what that means is that the Go language will try to take advantage of all the system resources available to it on the computer you're running. So if you've got, you know, like 16 Go routines and four cores, and they're all purely CPU bound, then you can run four, you know, it'll run four Go routines simultaneously. And so you get that staggered output typical of concurrent programming. So the second reason after performance is reliability. Statically typed, simple. So this is an example that I think shows a point where within Go you can do a lot with few lines of code while retaining readability. And so in this example, you've got this struct event processor, which is very similar to a C struct, and it has an event queue which is a channel of events. You can think of channels as first in, first out queues. And there's this add method on the event processor, which takes an event and adds it to the queue. And then a start method, which is an infinite for loop that will pop an event off the queue and then run its process method in the background in the Go routine. And so this is lacking, you know, the declaration for event and its process method. But other than that, like, this is all you really need to have this kind of functionality within your tool, right? Like, of course, this is not a full-fledged background worker system or anything like that. But if you just want these kind of small pieces in your tools, like, this is all you, this is it, or almost it. Testing is simple and built in to the standard library and within the tools that ship with Go. So you have this suffix, you know, underscore test.go, and when you run go test, it'll run those files. And it has some really cool features, like a built-in race detector. So if you add double dash race at the end, you don't have to make any changes to your tests. It will run the race detector. It's significantly slower as a result, but that's kind of what you get with that. Where it's looking for things like concurrent writes or concurrent write and read to the same place in memory. And it will let you know, like, here's the specific line of code where this is occurring. It was very awesome when doing concurrent programming. Error handling instead of exceptions. So Go does not have the concept of exceptions in its language. Instead, everything that can error or, you know, have an error will return an error as its last argument. So a common thing you'll see is something like this, where this takes no arguments and returns a string and an error. And the first thing it does is calls this function run, which returns a string and an error. And so this kind of thing you'll see a lot in Go, where you're saying if error does not equal nil, then handle the fact that I got an error, which in this case is to return, you know, empty string and the error. Else, you know, if it nil was returned, then there was no error, so continue on, in which case we're returning the string and nil. And this allows for very explicit handling of errors where they can occur within, you know, the Go programming language. And on the kind of the most simplistic end of the spectrum, you'll have something like this, where if a function, a common thing in the Go community is if a function shouldn't return an error, but instead should panic if an error case occurs, you'll see it usually prefixed with the word must. And so if error does not equal nil, panic. So the third one after performance and reliability is ease of use. So first off, the tooling. Go FMT or Go FMT is a code style formatter that ships the Go programming language. And so usually people will like bind it within their IDE or editor. So for me, it's like on save, it'll just run Go FMT on the language. And so you, to use it from the command line, you run go space FMT space your file and just rewrites and formats it. And for me, it's like, even if you don't agree with the code styles formatting that the Go team went with, consistency throughout the community is awesome. They chose tabs over spaces. I prefer spaces and everything else. But one of the awesome things with this tool is, like, I don't even have tabs in any way configured in my editor. I just run Go FMT and it will just replace it for me. And that consistency is awesome because, you know, if you're at all, before doing a lot of Go stuff, I was doing a lot of Python stuff, and the Python community is extremely fragmented in, like, what the code styles are. You know, there's this PEP8 document that most people don't follow all the way, and also anything before that, like, doesn't really follow it. So you've got tons of different styling throughout the community, and instead, you know, 99% of the Go code you'll see is formatted exactly the same. Testing, I talked about that. Go docs, it's just an you know, code comment to HTML documentation creator, very easy and awesome. Go build to build your binaries, and go run to run them. And when you run them, it treats it, it seems very much like a interpreted language. And then I put in Vim Go because I'm a Vim user, but, you know, tons of editor and IDE support. Familiarity. So this depends on your, you know, depending on your opinion of these languages, this might not be a good thing. For me, it was. Go has a lot of stylistic similarities to C and Python, and then taking a little bit from JavaScript. The library support is awesome. There's tons and tons of, you know, big, small, medium-sized organizations creating Go tooling and Go libraries and open sourcing them, as well as awesome individuals. And it's extremely easy to install them. So you set up this Go path environment variable as part of your installation, and then you're able to just run Go get, you know, the GitHub URL, and that will install it. Distribute a single binary anywhere. So with if I run in this project, if I call dbduke, if I run go build, I will get a dbduke binary. And since I'm running it on a, you know, MacBook Pro, it's going to be a binary built for 64-bit, you know, OS X, right? If I change this environment variable to go OS to Linux, then I get an ELF 64-bit executable. And if I change the architecture as well, then I get an ELF 32-bit executable. And something you'll notice here is that these are also statically linked. So cross compilation as well is just is a breeze. So I run this, you know, at Procore we run 64-bit Linux everywhere. So I run this command on any of my Go projects, and I've got a binary that I can just SCP up to the machine and run it, or package up and ship out. So performance, reliability, and ease of use. And to take a step back here, at Procore, we're mainly a Ruby on Rails shop within our web application. And, you know, and so within that, our operations team and security team, you know, use Ruby a lot. And we have tons of Ruby scripts and Bash scripts for interacting with Postgres. And a lot of those will stay around, and scripting languages are awesome. I don't want this to sound like I'm dissing those languages, but in a lot of the contexts, two of which I'll be talking here, where we needed to something a little bit more than that. Go was a great option where we were able to retain a lot of ease of use of using scripting languages while gaining a lot in performance and reliability. Where if you're coming from, you know, C, C++, Java, you know, the classically compiled languages, there's a lot of reasons to be using those languages. And I don't want to make the argument to stop using that, but the argument here is that there's a lot to gain in ease of use and reliability from those languages while retaining the performance. So let's go into interacting with Postgres in Go. So just take a little sidetrack. So in the standard library, there's this library database /SQL. Go uses slashes for sub-packaging. And it provides this kind of this core API for interacting with SQL databases. You implement the driver that actually interacts with the database, and then it provides API for doing like open close connections, begin rollback commit for transactions, exec for executing a statement, query for query row for a query that's only going to return a single row, and things like pinging the database and built-in connection pooling, etc. So my favorite driver for Postgres is lib/pq. You just run that to install it, and you use a little something like this. So at the top, you just import it the exact same way you installed it, and you get your connection parameters. It can take a string or this built-in object, and you call sql.open with the name of the driver and your connection parameters, and this will return a DB object. And with that, you can call query row or any of those other methods. And in this example, I've got this variable result that I want to put the result into. And so this query row method will return a row object, which I can call scan on and pass in the variable I want to put the result into. And so then we'll put the, you know, select one, we'll put one into this result variable and return an error. If error is equal to nil, then I continue on and I've got my result. So that's pretty much as much I'm going to talk directly about that direct API integration. But if you're interested, there's a great website that goes really in detail about interacting with all the different SQL databases, common SQL databases in Go. I recommend checking that out. But to go into some real world examples, PGNet Detective. This is a tool I wrote at Procore for analyzing Postgres network captures, that you get from like TCP dump. And Let me, so and it's open source, feel free to check it out. So let me tell a little story. About a little over a year ago now, my boss dropped this graph into our Slack channel. And what this is network traffic for our production database, with the y-axis being megabytes per second, and the blue line being bytes out of the database. So you see this spike up to about 105 megabytes a second going out of the database. We're like, what is going on? And so we start looking around, and we find this crazy rainbow graph that is the aggregate bytes in to our background worker servers. So this is seems to be where the traffic is going, from the production database into these background worker servers, seeing these massive spikes. The y-axis here is megabytes per second again, and you know, spikes up to about 70 megabytes a second going into these background worker servers. We're like, what is going on? You know, so we look at, you know, a slow query log that, and not really seeing anything. So we turn on full query logging, run that through PG Badger, just start looking around within our database and just not really seeing anything. And so I think, okay, let's take a network capture on one of these background worker servers. You know, we open that up in Wireshark, we start looking around and not really seeing anything that's indicative of these huge mass amounts of data. Like, okay, let's take a step back. What do we actually really want to accomplish here? We need to figure out what queries are coming into the database that are resulting in mass amounts of data going out. And sort of think, okay, let's take a capture on the production database and try to correlate, you know, queries coming into the data going out. And so I built this little prototype in Scapy, which is a Python library for doing packet manipulation. And it was super easy to do, and this worked great, but it was really, really slow. I was testing with a capture of about like 20 megabytes, and it was taking quite a while just because of the nature of, you know, what I was writing. There's a lot of looping. And so it just was taking like 20, 30 minutes for a small capture. And on that production database, you know, doing a capture, it was resulting in about a gigabyte every 10 seconds. So trying to get like a good sample size of like 2 minutes, a 12 gigabyte file, and just needed, you know, needed something faster. And so we decided to rewrite it in Go. And in, you know, the first thing I needed to find was something resembling Scapy, but for the Go programming language. And there was this great library created by Google called Go Packet, which provides packet processing capabilities for Go. And what it allowed me to do is, you know, on that capture file, loop through it, open it up, you know, lazy load and loop through it, and say, you know, if the destination port is 5432, meaning it's coming into the production, you know, the database server, and the payload, the TCP payload starts with a P or a Q, that means it's either a parse packet if it's a P, which is a prepared statement, or a query packet, then okay, that's a query coming in. You know, normalize the query, increase this counter, grab some metadata about it. Else, if it's the source port is 5432 and it's an ACK, it's a response back, so save that with the destination IP and the ACK and the size of the payload. And so what we can start to do here is correlate the queries coming in to the size of the packets going out. And ran this and got some output that looked like this. And what this is a catalog query or a schema query. We're trying to get the schema of this table drawing log imports. And the total was about, you know, 170 megabytes with a 1 to 1,000 query packet to response packet ratio. Like, this was very confusing for us. It was funny, when I first actually popped this into our chat, like, this was the results we got, my boss was like, no, there's a bug. No way, that's the actual result. So I went back and like looked through it, and there were some small bugs, but reran it and, you know, fixed those and reran it, and it was the same result. It's like very confusing as to why that would be the result of, you know, what was causing all this data going out. And so to to remind you guys, so Procore is a Ruby on Rails shop, and if you're not familiar with Ruby on Rails, the ORM that Ruby on Rails defaults to is something called Active Record. And Active Record is interesting in that it doesn't store the schema in code, but instead queries the database to get the schema of the table every time it interacts. So a process starts up, and it interacts with the model. So the model will query the database, get the schema, cache the schema, and use it. So on Rails applications, you will commonly see these catalog queries, but they're super, super fast, and they happen infrequently because they're cached. Like, so it only needs it the first time it interacts with the model. But there's something called ResQ, which is a background worker processing system for Rails written by GitHub, that every time it runs a job, it forks the process. And one of the problems with that is it loses that schema cache. So every time a job runs, every model it interacts with, it has to query the database. So when we start getting, you know, tens, thousands of jobs plus per hour running, you know, around maybe 1 to 8 tables being touched per job, average of 20 columns per table, like that's a lot of data that it has to get. And so at spikes, we were seeing like, it hitting what at the time was a one gigabit limit from the database server, with tons and tons of data. And so for that and many other reasons, we're moving to Sidekick, which is thread-based, so it's able to actually persist that schema cache. So with PGNet Detective, like where did Go win? Performance, absolutely. Do you mind if holding it to that? Thank you. Out of the box, like the default before I started trying to make it faster, it was significantly faster than what I was doing in Python. And then the other piece is community or ease, you know, which is a big piece of ease of use. Like I needed to find this library for doing packet manipulation. And I, you know, before I worked with Scapy, like I tried to find one in Ruby. And after that, when we needed something faster, we do a bunch of Rust at Procore. So it was like, okay, let me see if I can find one in Rust, and like couldn't find a library other than straight up like libpcap bindings, which I really didn't want to work with. So that was just a huge win for Go. So again, this is open source. Check it out. Let me know if it doesn't work for you. So the second example is dbduke. So dbduke is not open source and won't be. It's just, it's way too specific to Procore. But as I talk about this stuff, like it's not that it's like secret, super secret proprietary stuff. It's just very, very specific to Procore, so I don't think there'd be any value in us open sourcing it. But if you're at all interested in seeing pieces of code from this tool or anything, let me know. So to set some context, we restore, you know, staging QA testing databases frequently as in, often and a lot of them. It's important that they restore successfully. Because when a restore fails, productivity dies for QAs or for engineers. In the process, and then when they do fail, the process of kicking off these restores by hand is faulty. And what I mean by that is what it looked like was, someone on the ops team SSHing into the machine, creating a tmux, like listing out the cron jobs in the Postgres user because they're slightly different depending on the databases, like copying and pasting that and running it. And then just detaching from the tmux session because it's going to take a long time. And there's a lot of things that can go wrong with that process. So, and when these restores would fail, they would sometimes fail for very easily recoverable errors. So what we decided is we needed a tool for making restores of Postgres databases manageable and fault tolerant. And so this calls out to PG restore. So it utilizes that for doing the actual restore process, but kind of all of the other stuff surrounding it. So to talk quickly about the manageability piece, the idea here was run dbduke as a daemon with jobs rather than this, specific script that just runs, something that we can, easily use, something else to kind of kick off a job because it'll run for a long time. So the this is not anything complicated or, specifically like, cutting edge by any means. It's that doing this was extremely easy with Go. You have the core daemon process running, and when it needs to run a job, it just starts a Go routine. It runs the background, and you can use channels to easily communicate back and forth between the Go routine and the main process. And for looking at fault tolerance, the idea here was to treat restores as a state machine and recover from failure states. So you can get, for us, this was the simple state diagram that we use, where these databases that are constantly being restored are, in use, then they're ready to restore, then they're restoring, then they're ready for use, and from there they go back to being in use. And the failure state is going from restoring to fail to restore, and we want to bring it back to restoring. And you know, again, like, so what this is not anything cutting edge by any means, but rather that writing Go code the way Go wants you to write it allowed this to be very this to happen very easily by just handling the errors as they come. So that's the thing, right? It's like, as we go to these through these different states, you can easily see, like, within Go, what are the different errors that can occur as it goes, as the program goes through its flow, and just handling those properly. And so I wanted to quickly talk about what does that actually look like in practice. So I think, on the most simplistic side, is erroring out. So in dbduke, you know, if it can't connect to the Postgres database, this log fatal will basically just print this log message and then just panic and can alert the ops team. And yeah, and log a warning. So drop schema if exists underscore migration. That underscore migration schema is something for used by Sloney when we're doing major version upgrades. So if we're in the middle of that process while that the dump was created that this is being restored on, and it's trying to drop it, like, if it can't, that's okay. Like, don't blow up and, like, fail the restore process just because it can't drop that schema. Like, that's totally fine. Just log a warning so we know about it and continue on. And then retrying on the little bit more complex side, retrying with a timeout without a backoff. So I put with the timeout explicitly because so one of my lessons learned with writing dbduke and working with restoring databases is, like, you always want to have a timeout. I've had things where it's like, bugs where it tried to restore a database really, really fast for like 7 hours straight and just totally hosed the file system as well as the database. So that part's pretty necessary, but the with or without a back off is up to you, of course. So in this context, it's this is a method, a block till not in use. So blocking until no longer in that state of in use. And the code is very simple, right? Like, checking the state. And then if the state is in use, go into this for loop where we're sleeping for 15 seconds, quitting if the timeout succeeded, getting the current state, and then if we're no longer in use, break out of it. And so for both these pieces, manageability and fault tolerance, like, it's none of what I'm doing here is specifically that harder or by any means even close to being cutting edge, but rather that there wasn't anything like crazy about doing it. It was just writing Go code the way Go wanted you to write it. And like, that's the thing is after understanding like how Go wants you to run it, like, you just kind of start getting these pieces for free from how the language works fundamentally. And so where did Go win with dbduke other than that stuff is, you know, error handling being a huge piece for reliability, like going through these state transfers, you can directly see it every line of code. Like, if there's a potential error that can occur here, capture it and handle it explicitly. And then concurrency, which was a big piece for ease of use, wanting to do these background jobs. You just put the keyword Go and just runs in the background. So in conclusion, going back to that comparison of scripting languages to Go, like, there is a, I feel, I don't know, it's just that I feel like there's a lot to be gained in the reliability and performance while retaining that ease of use in scripting languages and starting to get these things for free when it comes to reliability. And from the compiled languages of, you know, C, C++, Java, you get to retain a lot of that performance while gaining hugely in ease of use and reliability. And Go is by no means, you know, this end-all be-all language. I think all these things that we talk about, you know, being adamant about them being the best is silly. These are just, you know, these are tools in our toolbox. And for me, it's like, in this context of building tools for interacting with Postgres, Go has just been a true delight. I hope you give it a try and like it out, and I hope this helps. So one last thing, which is if you like what I'm talking about, you want to build cool stuff with cool people, and you like these pictures, Procore is hiring. Thanks, guys. Did you have a question?
Yeah, so you mentioned that one query that was being run often or potentially a similar one. wasn't being, that particular query wasn't being run that many times, and the amount of data you were getting back was much larger than you might expect for a query like that compared to the size of the query.
Totally. So, yeah, and maybe I should have showed more of them. Yeah, that's a good, that's, thank you. Yeah, because so what it is with that table specifically is that it's a very, that is a very wide table. So doing that catalog query a lot can have some impact, but it was not nearly enough to bring that marker up. It was that the next preceding, you know, ones were all catalog queries as well. So yeah, that was more of a bad design on the side of the slide. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
Are there procedural, like, is this also, in, can you use Go as a PL language, or like use Python, et cetera?
Oh, sorry, as a what?
Like PL Python or?
Ah, no, there's no implementation for that at the moment. Any other questions? Yeah.
Could you speak a little bit to how you implemented testing for DBU? Did you use just the testing framework in Go, or did you guys use a separate testing framework, specifically unit testing?
Gotcha. Okay, so for specifically unit testing, the unit tests for DBU are you just using the standard library, and then there's, I didn't talk to it, but there's a library called Testify, which does some asserting. It's basically just allows, it's more of like just makes it a little bit nicer to do assertion testing within your unit tests. But DBDuke is mostly integration tests that actually, because of the process of like, you know, there's a bunch of Go code, and then it calls out to PG restore, and then there's a bunch of Go code. So you know, really testing that whole flow requires integration tests of actually doing that. No, we actually did use Postgres for doing that part. The mocking that is in place is just for, it calls out to something called a console, if you're familiar. That's a distributed key value store, and it uses console a lot for managing state, and so that you can actually, so that throughout the system it can know like what the state is of currently restoring databases, or if they've finished or whatever. And so that part is mocked within the unit tests, but not the actual calling out to Postgres. Of course. Any other questions? Awesome. Thanks, guys.